call the meeting in order. Good evening, South Brunswick. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic which stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Jersey Open Public Meeting Act was enacted to ensure the right of the public to have advance notice of and to attend the meetings of public bodies at which any business affecting their interest is discussed or acted upon. In accordance with the provisions of this act, the board secretary has caused notice of this meeting, including date, time, and location, to be posted in the South Brunswick Public Library and the board office, filed with the township clerk, and communicated with the Home News Tribune and the Star Ledger. Roll call, Mr. Pulaski, please.
Mr. Roger Krishna?
Yes.
Mr. Ray Keener? Mrs. Joyce Mehta?
Here.
Mr. Mike Mitchell?
Present.
Dr. Stephen Parker?
Here.
Dr. Smita Raj?
Here.
Mrs. Lisa Rogers?
Present.
Mr. Joseph Scaletti? Mr. Barry Nathanson.
Here.
We have a quorum.
Thank you. Can I get a motion to approve all tonight's agenda, please? Mr. Mitchell, made the motion to approve the agenda. I have a second.
Second.
Second by Mrs. Mehta. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Can I get a motion to go to executive session?
Motion.
Moved by Mrs. Meadows, second by Mrs. Roger. Raj, sorry.
Because it's back at 7.
Yeah, we're going to be back at 7, everyone. Be it resolved that the Board of Education and the Township of South Brunswick hereby moves into executive session in accordance with Sunshine Law, Chapter 231 of the Public Laws of 1975, NJSA 10:4-6 through 10:4-21, to discuss the following: personnel. Be it further resolved that the discussion conducted in executive session can be disclosed to the public at such time as the matters have been resolved. Formal action may be taken at any time, at any meeting. So this is notice to the public. We are going to executive session. We will be back at 7 o'clock. Thank you. Good evening, South Brunswick. We are back. Can I get a motion to reconvene?
Motion to reconvene.
Moved by Ray Keener. I have a second. Second by Dr. Parker. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, moving along now that we're back. Executive minutes of March 25th, 2021, and board minutes of March 25th, 2021. Get a motion.
Motion by Rogers.
Second. Moved by Mrs. Rogers, second by Ray Keener. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Moving along, report of the student representatives. Zoya.
Hello, good evening, everyone. So I'm gonna start off tonight by talking a little bit about what our student body has been up to the past month. So the Public Health Club just had an event where they encouraged students to create motivational and inspirational collages to just kind of uplift and give some comfort to students, because it is, you know, like the times. So Model UN also had their very last conference that they attended as a club. So that was CMUNC, Cornell Model UN Conference, and they did really well. There are two more Model UN conferences coming up, but students do need to register for those as an individual delegation. So on April 28th, so yesterday, our Incorruptible Us Club had a virtual takedown tobacco day. And also this week, Law Club hosted a special guest speaker, Zina Spezakis. She actually ran for Congress this cycle. She did lose, but she ran against an incumbent, and she also launched a new project called the Fair Ballot Project. And it was a really interesting experience, and for everyone involved, they got to ask her different questions about her experiences on Wall Street and her transition to becoming, trying to become a politician. So that was a really cool experience. And speaking of guest speakers, South Brunswick was very, very lucky to host a very special one. Miss Elizabeth Eckford of the Little Rock Nine actually visited us for a school-wide virtual author visit. So 2,117 students and staff had the privilege to spend an hour with Ms. Eckford and her co-authors, Dr. Yuridai Stanley and 18-year-old Grace Stanley, to hear about the challenges that she faced while integrating Central High School in 1957. It was framed around her book, The Worst First Day, Bullied While Desegregating Central High School. Ms. Eckford fielded questions from SBHS students on her experience and stressed the importance of standing up to bullies. Mrs. Donato and Mrs. Manganello were really excited to host such an important event for our school community, and we were really excited to be able to interact with her and hear her story. It was a really, really special experience, and we're honored that she spoke to us. So May is right around the corner. It's only 2 days away. It's crazy. End of the school year is approaching, and that also means that Teacher Appreciation Week is coming up. So students, we had a really tough time this year, but teachers had an equally challenging time. They had to completely rework how to teach virtually, and they have really done a lot for us. So the next week, maybe take a moment to thank your teachers. The 3G committee, they created an initiative of Thank a Teacher. So it's a form available on every single Google Classroom. You can fill it out, say something nice to your teachers. You can send them an email, send them like a virtual card. Like, there's so many things you can do. Show them that you appreciate them. Backing Volunteers also had a teacher appreciation initiative that will be shared next week. They created a video montage of around 60 students saying how they appreciate our teachers. So that's right next week, May 3rd through May 7th. So upcoming events, Viking Volunteers very recently just finalized paint night. So it is happening on June 8th from 4 to 6, and this is a fundraising night. In the past, they have raised thousands of dollars from this event, and it's a really special event that they get to do every year. So we encourage everyone to check that out. Chipotle night is also coming up. Amnesty International is hosting one on May 8th, so take a break from cooking and go get some Chipotle and support a really great cause. VLA is hosting a food drive for Middlesex County. There are bins all around high school, so it's at the main entrance, and it's also outside the activities office. So this is not only limited to South Brunswick High School students, it's a district-wide thing. If you would like to donate, then please do so and drop it off at any of the locations I just mentioned. Clubs are also getting ready to start elections, so election season is coming up. Class councils are getting ready, student councils are getting ready. I know a couple clubs I'm in, we're all just gearing up for the next year and making preparations for that as well. So the Pirandello Players have their play coming up, and they have a shirt sale. So their shirts are Little Women themed, and they are $15 each, and all funds will go directly to support them and the play. The Interact Club is hosting a Habitat for Humanity walk on May 15th at the high school. And tomorrow, I feel like I've been talking about this forever, but Mr. SBHS is tomorrow. We've been hard at work. All the guys have been practicing their dance. They're amazing at it now. And we have some really cool talents. So I really encourage everyone to check it out. It's being streamed at 6 tomorrow, and you can find it on the VTN YouTube channel. It's going to be live streamed, so that's going to be really fun. So a couple of reminders. So I touched on this last time as well, but I think it's really important, so I'm going to mention it again. So tomorrow is a really important day for AP exam stuff. So tomorrow's the last day to cancel your exam and get a refund. You can cancel your exam at a later time, but you won't get your money back. So that's very important to keep in mind, especially for seniors, because you kind of know if you're getting credit or not at the colleges you're going to. Also, tomorrow is the last day to switch from in-person to virtual. These deadlines are very strict, actually, so just make sure that you get it in. And also, you cannot change from virtual to in-person. So if you're in virtual, you just take the exam virtually. There is a lot of senior stuff actually coming up. So commitment day is literally the day after tomorrow, and I'm sure a lot of you already know where you're going. So we encourage everyone to send their commitments and where they're going to college to the SB Commitment Instagram. The Class Council of 2021 is running it, and there's like a lot of posts there already. So send over your information so that we can all celebrate each other and the next journey that we're really going on. The school also wants to help celebrate us. So National Commitment Day is on Saturday, but on May 5th, we will be recognizing students and their colleges in school. So you can send a picture. There's a Google form on the classroom, and the teachers are going to be making a collage to kind of recognize everyone. Also, there is on Monday is also the deadline to submit the pictures of you and your friends for the walk through memory lane. So there's more information coming about that soon, but again, it's just a thing for seniors to kind of celebrate their time during high school. I really encourage you all the time, but really get those pictures in so you guys can be celebrated. Project graduation, again, just a reminder, the form is due on May 15th, and it has to be done by a parent. I know some people have been doing it themselves, but like, it literally records your email address, so just get your mom or dad to do it. So that's all that we have for activities, the activities department tonight. Now I will be talking about the athletics department. So the boys tennis team has won 3 consecutive matches against New Brunswick, Piscataway, and Edison to improve to 3-2. Team co-captain Veyas Pujari led the Vikings with wins against all 3 opponents. Shreyas Menon captured his first singles victory against Edison in his debut at third singles. Team co-captain Gagandeep Gotra has stepped in to play first singles to support the team and went 2-1 in the streak. Now I'm going to list off the dates, as always, of upcoming home athletic events. So Monday, May 3rd, boys golf will be going against East Brunswick. Softball will be going against Edison. On Tuesday, May 4th, girls golf will be going against Old Bridge. Baseball will be going against East Brunswick. Boys spring track will be going against Old Bridge. On Wednesday, May 5th, girls golf will be going against Allentown. Softball will be going against East Brunswick. On Thursday, May 6th, boys golf will be going against Saraville. Boys tennis will be going against Monroe. Boys volleyball will be going against JFK. Girls lacrosse will be going against Edison. And on Friday, boys volleyball will be going against Piscataway. So, and as always, you can always access the athletic schedule on Middlesex Greater County Conference, like that website that I've mentioned a few times. It's always there. So yeah, those are all my announcements for tonight. Thank you.
Moving along, Mr. Federer, superintendent.
Right. So tonight,
this is going to be land speed record, right?
Tonight we have a few cool things happening. We have the Teacher and Support Person of the Year. We're going to honor those folks. Very excited. It comes right on the heels of Staff and Teacher Appreciation Week, which is May 3rd through 7th. And we can sit here all day and give kudos to our staff for this last year, recognizing and acknowledging their strengths. The genius that they've showed in understanding all facets of what we've had to deal with during this pandemic, all have continued to demonstrate daily that no obstacle is too big, no situation insurmountable, and when it comes to the students, they're just amazing. So thank you to all, and we'll be honoring our winners as well shortly. A quick note to the community and to the board, for the remainder of this school year, I don't really get too many questions at this point. But I just want to be clear with our community and with the board. There's no schedule changes happening for the remainder of the school year. Between now and June 22nd, the schedules will stay identical to what they are. The ability for elementary students to continue to come into the school is pretty much closed. There might be exceptions, but at this point, everyone's on waiting lists, and there's just nothing else we can do about that at this point. We cannot add more kids to the point where we'd have to cohort the kids or cut the days into half days. So we're kind of stuck in this mode right now. Middle school and high school schedules will stay exactly as they are. Students will still go home exactly when they go home from in person and finish their day at home. Virtual students will still remain virtual. So again, no change. Whatever we've been doing this week, we're going to be doing next week. When it comes to next year, what I'm just going to say is we're still waiting. And I'll be doing full-blown forums and all of that again once we get more information from the state. We're still waiting. Once we get that information, we'll know more. The only thing that's been stated so far about next year was stated by the governor that there'd be no virtual learning next year. I don't know if that will stick, but that's the only thing anyone has heard at this point. That was said about 2 or 3 weeks ago at one of the 1 o'clock press conferences. Until we hear more, we're not ready to start having those conversations, but we will be putting out surveys at some point and getting information so we can make great decisions for next year. Hopefully, just back in school, all kids, that's the goal. End of year activities, just so you know kind of how the rules are working. First of all, for graduation, for high school graduation, we'll be doing it at the Cure Center, and we're finalizing, hopefully, be able to have everybody together. Some good news about that. Prom is going to happen. There are new good rules put out about that, so that's all being applied, and those families and students will be spoken with and given all that information shortly. When it comes to fifth grade and eighth grade, they're all working on their plans as well. But those things are going to happen. So that's the good news. Things are going to happen for kids. And as far as events at the end of the year, there will not be nearly what we normally do, but hopefully we'll be able to do some level of events that kids are used to having, just to give them something special before the year's over. Again, that will be happening school by school, and families and students will hear about that from their schools. A quick announcement about kindergarten registration. It's going to be completely remote this year for everyone's safety. Appointments can be made on our website. Just go to the website. Kindergarten enrollment this year, we really need people to register so that we get an idea of what we're looking at for next year. That's very important to us. So that's it. My report is short tonight. What I'm going to do is I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Disler, who's going to do a little PSA about the art gallery.
Yeah, I'm excited to let everybody know that another area of such pride in South Brunswick is our art program. Our art education is top-notch, and we have students that really appreciate it, are so talented, and when asked, it really has made a difference for them to be in art classes all throughout the district, especially during this pandemic. And tonight, like every other year, we are still having our art gallery, our student art gallery. This is the 16th annual Joanne Kirkus Student Art Gallery, and I have to say a few thank yous. First off, to Blair Eisman and Kristen Laskin. They are the art supervisors for our district, and all of the teachers involved, all of our student artists. And this year, the forum that we're using, the platform is a web-based platform. So a special thank you to our tech coaches in the district that helped with this. Nicole Hunter, Kyle Nemus, and Tracy Rico, they're using something that's called eMaze, and it actually is very interactive. And so without further ado, Rebecca Bufis, one of our art teachers, created this short PSA to introduce this year's art gallery, and it will be available for our district beginning tomorrow through our district website, and it will be accessible till the end of the school year. So can't wait for you to see it, and hit it, guys.
That ends my report, Mr. Nathanson.
Thank you.
I think you could stay where you are, ladies and gents. I'm going to come out there to you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Dr. Biswood is back with presenting the 2020-2021 Educators and Support Staff of the Year. I assume she's...
Okay. Yeah, thank you. I'm really excited to turn the program over to Blair Eisman. She's going to join us remotely, and I'm so excited. I see you in the camera there, Blair, so we're ready when you are.
You're all set.
Thank you.
Are you still at work?
Well, I left and came back. I trust the internet here better than I do at home. So good evening, everyone, members of the board, our honorees, their friends, family, colleagues, everyone tuning in. I'm Blair Eisman, Supervisor of Professional Development, and I have the privilege of honoring our 2021 Educators and Educational Support People of the Year. It is truly one of my favorite parts of my job. This recognition program has been a tradition in district dating back to 1996, and there are a lot of people involved. So our staff and families and students are invited to send in nomination letters. We have a selection committee that reads every single one. This year we had about 350 nomination letters come in. So thank you to our nomination, both writers and readers. I also want to thank our administration for, they always get the fun job of sharing the news in their building, giving the announcement for our honorees, and they also contributed to the presentation tonight, so thank you to them. Thank you, as always, to our Board of Education for their support, to Mary Ann Murphy for always helping advertise the recognition program throughout the district. A big heartfelt thank you to my assistant, Rachel Kalibas, for all the behind-the-scenes work from start to end. It's a lot of small pieces and details, and I couldn't do it without her, and we have a great time working on the event. Also, tradition is PTO participates in this yearly. They always show their generosity in purchasing one of the gifts for each of our honorees. So we're happy that they continued to show their generosity this year. And a thank you to the SB Ed Foundation also, because they reached out this year and they eagerly asked, how can we help celebrate our honorees? So they purchased a gift for each of the honorees too. So these gifts were delivered today to the honorees, but they were given strict instructions not to open them until now. So consider this the official go-ahead, honorees, to tear open your gifts, because I'm going to tell everyone what they are. So some of you may recall that the theme for this recognition program over the past few years has been centered around a single book. But this year, I'm focusing on inspirational book characters of many books rather than just one title. The same way that characters are the heart of great literature, our educators and educational support people are truly the heart of our district. Not only do we see them, we feel them, and they stay with us long after a book ends. So as I celebrate each honoree tonight, I'm going to share with them and with you the inspirational book character that was chosen for them and the book that the Ed Foundation purchased for them. A shout out to Lisa Maganello, librarian at the high school, on brainstorming our character list with me. So thank you to her. Each honoree is also going to get a beautiful desk plate that the PTO purchased for them to display proudly, and they'll also going to get a certificate from the Board of Education. So lots of goodies, and we're excited. So without further ado, I'm going to start at Brooks Crossing. Mrs. Jennifer Klein, fifth grade. Never forget who you are, and never forget who loves you. And although I can hear Jen saying that to her students, this is a quote from Corduroy by Don Freeman. And the same way that Corduroy is a classic book, so is Jen Klein. She's a problem solver. She's determined. She understands the importance of kindness and love, and she always wants to make sure that everyone feels seen and valued, and we appreciate her. So congratulations to Jen. Mrs. Kimberly Knapp, paraprofessional at Brooks Crossing, don't ever let someone call your life, your dreams, little. That's a quote from the story Ghost by Jason Reynolds, and Mrs. Knapp makes sure that our littlest learners over at Dean's know that they have big, bright futures ahead of them. Like Ghost, Mrs. Knapp overcomes obstacles with dedication and hard work. Congratulations to you, Kim. Miss Kimberly Bastori, fifth grade teacher at Brunswick Acres. Courage, kindness, friendship, character. These are the qualities that define us as human beings and propel us on occasion to greatness. A quote from Wonder by R.J. Palacio. And like August, Miss Bastori is a hero, a diamond in the rough who proves that you can't blend in when you were born to stand out. And she makes sure that her students know that they were born to stand out too. Congratulations, Kim. Miss Megan Ionello, paraprofessional at Brunswick Acres. If everyone decided nothing could change, nothing ever would. That's a quote from Amal Unbound by Aisha Saeed. And like Amal, Megan is brave and knows the importance of thinking beyond the status quo. Our staff and students benefit greatly from Megan's work and heart. Congratulations to you, Megan. Mrs. Sarah Shadell, instructional support at Cambridge. What's the point in having a voice if you're going to be silent in those moments when you shouldn't be? A quote from The Hate U Give by Angie Thomas. Mrs. Shadell uses her voice to advocate for her students. Like Star, she has the tenacity to stand up for who and what she believes in. Congratulations, Sarah. Mrs. Eileen Cicero, SIS secretary at Cambridge. You can nearly always enjoy things if you make up your mind firmly that you will. A quote from Anne of Green Gables by L.M. Montgomery. And like Anne, Eileen shows grit and determination to make her mark on the world. She is passionate, warm, intelligent, and loyal with a great imagination. Congratulations, Eileen. Mrs. Krista DeLakian, LLD teacher at Constable. Taking risks and making choices in spite of fear, it's what makes our life story compelling. A quote from With the Fire on High by Elizabeth Acevedo. Like Imani, Mrs. DeLakian finds the courage to pursue her passion, even if at times it seems impossible. She takes risks for her students because she knows the rewards will be worth it. Congratulations, Krista. For Constable's Support Person of the Year, we actually have a dynamic duo that you can find in the main office, Taisha Edwards, SIS Secretary, and Stephanie Vicadomini, Principal Secretary. So we're going to start with Taisha. We can't take any credit for our talents. It's how we use them that counts. A quote from A Wrinkle in Time by Madeline Langle. Like Meg, Taisha has shown that she's fearless and understands the importance of working with others, but she also knows that it's important to be confident in her judgment and to trust herself. Congratulations, Taisha. Mrs. Stephanie Vicadomini, Principal Secretary at Constable. Friends are like training wheels for a bike. They always keep you from falling down. And Stephanie has definitely lifted Constable up. Like Jordan, Stephanie, I'm sorry, that was a quote from New Kid by Jerry Kraft. And like Jordan, Stephanie has had to adjust to a new school, but she's shown strength and courage to take care of herself and her colleagues. Congratulations, Stephanie. Mrs. Jessica Da Silva, kindergarten teacher at Greenbrook. Come right up close to me and I will show you something wonderful. A quote from James and the Giant Peach by Roald Dahl. James's optimism helps him to overcome difficult times, to find adventure and friendship. And we see the same qualities in Mrs. Da Silva through her positivity and excitement, which she brings to her classroom and her students every day. Congratulations, Jessica. Miss Bridget Pagano, paraprofessional at Greenbrook. Please look after this bear. Thank you. That was on the label of Paddington in A Bear Called Paddington by Michael Bond. Ms. Pagano definitely takes care of our students. Like Paddington, she also makes the everyday ordinary things quite extraordinary. Paddington is respected and loved just like Ms. Pagano. Congratulations to you. Mrs. Kristen Conowitz, special education teacher at Indian Fields. Two creatures who shared a love for motorcycles naturally spoke the same language. A quote from A Mouse and a Motorcycle by Beverly Cleary. Like Ralph S. Mouse, Mrs. Conowitz makes meaningful connections to staff and students, and she brings excitement to learning, her classroom, and all of Indian Fields. Congratulations, Kristen. Mrs. Anna Kosa, paraprofessional, Indian Fields. You can't control how other people think and act, but you're in full control of you. A quote from Dear Martin by Nick Stone. Like Justice, Mrs. Kosa is thoughtful and intelligent and knows she has the power to make a real difference. Congratulations, Anna. Miss Sophia Pellegrinus, third grade, Monmouth Junction. Go on with what your heart tells you, or you will lose it all. And that's a quote from Percy Jackson and The Lightning Thief by Rick Riordan. Miss Pellegrinus follows her heart. She is an advocate and shows perseverance and bravery as she overcomes challenges, just like Percy Jackson. Congratulations, Sophia. Mrs. Anna Maria Callett, paraprofessional at Monmouth Junction. May it be a light to you in dark places when all other lights go out. A quote from The Fellowship of the Ring by J.R.R. Tolkien. Like Eowyn, Mrs. Callett is definitely a light. She faces hardship with strength and courage. She wants to do what's right, and she walks towards challenges that others might back away from. Congratulations, Anna Maria. Miss Angela Fasanella, Language Arts at Crossroads North. If you knew time as well as I do, you wouldn't talk about wasting it. And that's a quote from Alice in Wonderland by Lewis Carroll. Like Alice, Miss Fasanella is courteous and loving, wildly curious and responsible. When the chips are down, you see her spunk. Congratulations, Angela. Mr. Kenneth Potts, custodian at Crossroads North. You have been my friend. That in itself is a tremendous thing. A quote from Charlotte's Web by E.B. White. Like Charlotte, Ken uses his wit and wisdom to support his friends with small acts of kindness, and that's seen and felt all throughout Crossroads North. Congratulations, Ken. Mrs. Nancy Maurer, Language Arts, Crossroads South. There are all kinds of courage. A quote from Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone by J.K. Rowling. Like Harry, Mrs. Maurer inspires people in their darkest moments. She has comforted those who needed it most. She taught us that love and friendship are the most important things in the world. Congratulations, Nancy. Mr. Carl Cavajon, custodian at Crossroads South. Somewhere inside all of us is the power to change the world. A quote from Matilda by Roald Dahl. Like Matilda, Ken is kind and courteous and courageous and develops and uses his gifts to benefit the greater good. He also has left his mark on South. Congratulations, Ken. Mrs. Lauren Morris, Social Studies, South Brunswick High School. They open a door and enter a world. A quote from The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe by C.S. Lewis. Like Lucy, Miss Morris is faithful. She believes in something when no one else does and teaches us to be true to ourselves. She opens doors for students and they love coming into her world. Congratulations, Lauren. Mr. Daniel Zippo, head custodian at the high school. Look at everything as though you're seeing it for either the first time or last time. Then your time on earth will be filled with glory. A quote from A Tree Grows in Brooklyn by Betty Smith. Like Francie, Mr. Zippo has a positive outlook. He's generous and caring. He is observant and pays attention to those small details. He shows grit in tackling all of the obstacles he faces. Congratulations, Dan. And last but certainly not least is Mr. John Pisnar, technology for our district. A little consideration, a little thought for others makes all the difference. A quote from Winnie the Pooh by A.A. Milne. And like Winnie the Pooh, there's a sense of simplicity and genuine care when you're talking with John. He's a happy place. He's a great friend and colleague. He's thoughtful, steadfast, and clever. He is a beloved quote-unquote character in our district. He has helped so many, and we are appreciative. Congratulations, John. So to close out our recognition, our honorees administrators wanted to say some congratulations and gush about their folks for a little bit. So I have their video messages in all compiled into one video that I will share with you now.
I'm Jamie Macaron, principal at Brooks Crossing, and it is my privilege to honor Mrs. Jennifer Klein as Brooks Crossing's Educator of the Year. Mrs. Klein has a way of making her students all feel like they're her only students. The theme in Mrs. Klein's classroom is that of the picture book Corduroy. She emphasizes looking beyond first impressions, fostering strong friendships, and creating a sense of belonging. She weaves these themes throughout her class while making the hard work of learning feel attainable and fun. Congratulations, Mrs. Klein. You deserve this honor.
I'm Lisa Rogel, assistant principal at Brooks Crossing School, and I'm thrilled to speak to you about Kimberly Knapp, our Educational Support Person of the Year. Kim is amazing. She has worn many hats at Brooks Crossing over the last few years. This year, she is supporting our kindergartners at the Dean's Campus. Kim loves every child she works with, and they love her too. She is supportive of teachers, and she is truly an asset to the whole building. Congratulations, Mrs. Knapp. This is a truly well-deserved honor.
A huge congratulations to our Educator of the Year, Kim Bastori. Kim's enthusiasm and creativity in the classroom is contagious. She knows her students deeply and is able to motivate and encourage them to do their best, even in the hardest of times. Kim has always been a leader in instructional technology, and this year she has truly been able to use that knowledge and talent to excite her students to come to virtual class every day. Her gifts extend beyond the classroom, and she tries to make Brunswick Acres the best we can be as a school. Congratulations, Kim.
I am honored to recognize Megan Iannello, a paraprofessional in our autism program at Brunswick Acres, as our Educational Support Person of the Year. When you work with Megan, you're immediately able to see the passion and enthusiasm she has for her work and how tirelessly she works to support students and staff. Megan's always looking out for the best interest of her students and goes above and beyond to support them. Megan brings a positive light to our students, families, the autism program, and our entire school community. Congratulations, Megan. We are so thrilled to celebrate you.
Hi, my name is Christy Pemberton. I'm the principal of Cambridge School. I'm here to recognize Ms. Sarah Shadell as our Teacher of the Year. As our K-2 instructional support teacher, Mrs. Shadell makes learning fun and consistently challenges her students to reach for new heights in their learning. As a colleague, Mrs. Shadell is a model teacher leader who is full of energy, positivity, and has a supportive spirit that inspires and motivates those she works with. Like the main character star from the book, The Hate U Give, Mrs. Shadell relies on integrity and passion to do what's best for kids and uses her platform to help others do the same.
It is my pleasure to speak on behalf of Mrs. Eileen Cicero, our Student Information Secretary at Cambridge. When we talk about silver linings, Eileen is definitely the silver lining at Cambridge. She's enthusiastic, she's friendly, she's always got a smile on her face and a sparkly headband whenever she can. And thank you so much for all you do. You deserve this recognition tremendously. Thank you so much.
Miss Christina Vesey, and I'm the proud principal of Constable School. It's an honor to be here with you, albeit virtually, to recognize Mrs. Krista Delakian, Constable's 2020-2021 Educator of the Year. To know Krista is to love her. She's an exceptional educator and an even better person. She loves her students and believes in the infinite potential in each of them. To continue with this year's inspirational book characters theme, Krista reminds us of Emily in the book With the Fire on High, because she pursues her passion even when it seems impossible. We love you, Krista, and couldn't be more thrilled for you.
Congratulations, Taisha Edwards, for your well-deserved Educational Support Person of the Year Award. It is such an honor to celebrate you in this way. You have co-constructed the Constable Schools Command Center as a well-organized yet delightfully designed machine. Your transformational contributions are noteworthy. Like Meg, in A Wrinkle in Time, to work in the main office, you are so brave, work as a strong team, and display confidence in using your best judgment. Taisha, your journey has just begun, and we are so happy for you.
The school knows who really runs the school building, our secretaries, better known as our right hands. I'm honored to be with you tonight to virtually recognize my beloved secretary, Mrs. Stephanie Vicodomini, as our Educational Support Person of the Year. Stephanie is new this year, but being new during a pandemic didn't slow her down one bit. Stephanie's organized, a quick learner, and a real people person. Her warmth, positivity, and willingness to jump right in have made a huge difference this year. She's like Jordan in the book, The New Kid, who uses his talents to overcome challenges in a new school. Congratulations, Stephanie!
Hi, I'm Jody Mahoney, principal of Greenbrook Elementary School, and it is my pleasure to recognize and celebrate Mrs. Jessica DeSilva, one of our kindergarten teachers. Just like the character James in James and the Giant Peach, her optimism helps her to overcome difficult times, like teaching kindergarten during a pandemic. She guides each student toward finding adventure and a love of learning while also making new friends along the way. Mrs. DeSilva, you are so fun to be around and make learning magical every day. Congratulations on being the Greenbrook 2021 Educator of the Year.
I'm happy to congratulate our Greenbrook School Education Support Person of the Year, Mrs. Bridget Pagano. Ms. Pagano, thank you for all that you do for our Greenbrook students, for our youngest students who may need the most support. You're a friend, you're a support, you're a cheerleader, and you're all the wonderful things that we want our students to have. Thank you so much for being a silver lining at Greenbrook School.
Hi, I'm Peter Ratine, principal at Indian Fields. We celebrate Kristen Conowitz, a teacher who works tirelessly with students in need of support and is an amazing advocate for them. Ms. Conowitz is positive and encouraging, and like Ralph S. Mouse, creates an exciting atmosphere and brings her students on a learning adventure. She does all of this while having high expectations for her students. Also like Ralph S. Mouse, she is a most trusted colleague, resource, and friend for many staff members. Congratulations, Kristen.
Hello, I'm Allison Dubois, Assistant Principal of Indian Fields. I'm honored to recognize Anna Cosa as our Support Person of the Year. Anna works tirelessly all over our building, keeping us happy, healthy, and safe. Anna's work ethic and energy are inspiring, much like Justice from Dear Martin. Like Justice, Anna is loyal, thoughtful, and a good friend and colleague. Congratulations, Anna. We are stronger because you are a part of the Indian Fields community.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Edmonds, principal of Monmouth Junction School, and it's my privilege to be able to celebrate Sophia Pellegrinus, our Educator of the Year. Mrs. Pellegrinus is a master teacher, and actually, she's like a superhero. All of us who are privileged to work with her, to see the amazing things she does in her classrooms, and the families and the students who are lucky enough to have her this year as their teacher, know that she's just amazing. So congratulations, Mrs. Pellegrinus. We're so proud of you. And now I'd like to congratulate Anna Maria Callett, our Educational Support Person of the Year at Monmouth Junction. Anna Maria works with our littlest children. She's a member of our preschool handicap team. And that means she helps children off the bus, gets them safely to class, helps them take off their jackets, do their activities, eat snack, all these expectations of school that our littlest children are learning. Congratulations, Anna Maria. We are so blessed to have you with us.
We'd like to offer huge and heartfelt congratulations to Ms. Angela Fasanella, seventh grade literature teacher in the Row Unit at Crossroads North. Ms. Fasanella is our 2020-2021 Educator of the Year at Crossroads North, and this is so well deserved on her part. Ms. Fasanella is so thoughtful in what she wants to provide for her students and also about the kind of teacher that she wants to be. Like the storybook character Alice in Alice in Wonderland, she inspires her students to dream. Alice famously said, "Curiouser and curiouser," and that's what she encourages her students to be through the exploration of literature, and she brings stories to them that bring meaning in their life. Ms. Fasanella, you deserve to be recognized. Congratulations on this honor, and well-deserved being Crossroads North's 2020-2021 Teacher of the Year.
Hi, I'm Mark Riccardi, Assistant Principal at Crossroads North Middle School, and it is my honor this evening to recognize Crossroads North's Educational Support Professional of the Year, Mr. Ken Potts. Ken, along with the entire custodial staff, is the backbone of this school. The myriad of small acts performed by Ken each day add up to a school that is safe, warm, and welcoming to our students and staff. Anytime you ask Ken to do something, he responds with, "I got it," and you know it's already done. Congratulations, Ken. We couldn't be prouder of the work you do.
Good evening. My name is Bonnie Capes, and I'm the very proud principal of Crossroads South Middle School. Tonight, I have the honor to recognize Mrs. Nancy Maurer as our Educator of the Year. Nancy is a language arts teacher with the Beta Unit. She is the heart and soul of Crossroads and drives us all to be the best that we can. Anybody who knows her knows that she loves, values, and appreciates every student who comes through her doors. Nancy, we are better for having known you. Congratulations. So well deserved.
Good evening. I'm Sandra Henson, Assistant Principal at Crossroads South, and I have the honor and privilege of recognizing our Support Person of the Year, Mr. Carl Cravajon. Carl has been a custodian here at Crossroads South for the past 26 years, and there's no job too big or small that he can't handle. He knows our building inside and out. A special note, our library was renovated over this past school year, and Carl painted the entire library and put all the final touches on the renovations. Carl, congratulations on your honor, and we thank you.
Congratulations to South Brunswick High School's Teacher of the Year, Ms. Lauren Morris. Ms. Morris is involved in everything at the high school. She's so detail-oriented, organized, so supportive. So many teachers, staff, students just recognize everything that she does here, and we're so excited to honor her this evening. So way to go, Ms. Morris. Keep up the great work, and it's really, we're fortunate to have you part of our high school. Go Vikings.
Hi, this message is for Danny Zippo. Danny, you work as hard as anyone I know. Anytime we need you for absolutely anything, you answer us by stating, "Don't worry, we'll get it done." Your grit in tackling everything that comes up is very inspiring. Congratulations on being named the South Brunswick High School's Educational Support Person of the Year. Congratulations, Danny.
Congratulations, John. You really deserve this.
Congratulations on winning this awesome award. You're an awesome person and co-worker.
Hey, John, I just want to congratulate you, man. Thank you. Thank you for everything.
Your ability to just keep going and going and going, the Letterizer Bunny stuff. Congrats again. Thanks.
Congratulations, John. Well deserved. We love you.
Congratulations, John!
Of course, our tech team had to come in big at the end. For those of you that don't know, John Pisnar is a big Peanuts and Charlie Brown fan, so we had to throw that in for him. Congratulations again to everyone, all of our honorees tonight. It was a joy to celebrate you, and I turn it back over to Mr. Nathanson.
Well, I appreciate it, and I want to congratulate all educators and educational support persons of the year honorees. Unfortunately, we're not doing this in person where I would be able to shake your hand and give your gifts out, but we know most of you are on, and it's still a big honor, and I want to on behalf of the Board of Education, I want to congratulate all of you. Moving along to the public hearing, as far as the 2021-2022 budget, Mr. Fetter and David Pulowski.
It's presentation night at the South Brunswick.
All right, everybody, welcome. We have some good news to report. Basically, the preliminary budget that we adopted about
March 21st.
So about a month ago, there's really no change. That's unusual. Often there is something that happens. Nothing has happened. It's kind of, so this is going to be a bit repetitive. I apologize. But for the public that didn't get a chance to see this the last time, Dave and I are going to go through this. And I think we have an opening from Ray.
Yes, we do.
Ray, you have some words before we start?
Thank you, Mr. Fetter, Mr. Pulowski. Just wanted to let you know that the Board of Ed Finance Committee, in conjunction with Mr. Fetter, the superintendent, and Mr. Pulowski, the business administrator, put together a budget this year that we feel improves the student programs during these uncertain financial times. You will see in our presentation tonight that over the course of the past 4 years, the school taxes have decreased. There are a number of factors that cause this scenario. For example, our township ratables have increased dramatically, keeping South Brunswick in one of the lowest equalized tax rate in Middlesex County. As an S2 school district that is slated for over $9 million in cuts, we are concerned for the future of our district. Although we only saw about $250,000 cut this year, we still have our eye and are unsure of the future, and will continue to seek out revenue generating and savings programs that will support all of our students, our employees, and our buildings. So if you would, give us the details.
So we're gonna go through and just kind of talk about some important financials that help to kind of define how the budget operates. The first one, and the one that's been the most talk over the last few years, has been state aid. State aid is the amount of money the state gives the district to offset the costs provided by the township's monies and the federal monies. So this year we're slated to lose a little bit of money. We'll get through that shortly. Unlike any other year, we have this money called CARES Act money and ESSER money and money from the federal government due to the pandemic. So that's been interesting. The district has not received that much money in comparison to other districts. But it is going to be money that's going to be put to use. And these are the four basic areas that we look at. Is our staffing associated with what we want to do with our kids next year? What materials do we need? We still have unknowns. We don't really know everything yet for next year. What will the PPE situation be? Will there be any other expenses that need to be accounted for? And the big deal for us is the impact on learning. Right now, just to give you a number that's not part of this budget, is the coming money we're expected to receive is about $4 million over the next 2 years, in addition to the budget, solely to be used for pandemic impact expenses. So that is kind of a grant money, not in our operating lines. Another big impact on our budget has been a change in the way that healthcare is offered to public school employees. That is kind of a good thing for employees in that their healthcare costs went down. It does have an impact on the budget of about $500,000 in negative money, but we're managing that as well. And that's just one of the impacts. And another big area for us is revenues. Still all due to the pandemic, we expect to see reduced revenues from our normal amount in Summer Institute. Community education has a very, very large number of unknown variables right now, so we can't even predict exactly what that's going to look like yet. Facilities rentals, as you know, this last year we had $0 in facilities rentals. That's down from about $250,000 usually in rental money. So next year, I couldn't tell you. So we're predicting almost guaranteed a loss of that. And then there's the food service. We normally have a guaranteed amount of money from the food service. As you know, that next year food is again free. Food will be free to all students for the fiscal school year coming up. So that will have an impact one way or the other on our revenues associated with that. So that's just kind of a general outlook of things. And we'll talk to you about this concept I've talked to over the years about a deficit model. For us, again, we go into the next year with fixed expenses. We have staffing costs, we have healthcare, we have energy, we have things that cost money every year. And the state has removed $257,000 from that state aid number. So what that really means for us is we are always in a cut mode. What do we have to cut? The good news is, you know, we have a really good business administrator. This guy named David is sitting next to me. And he figures out ways to make it so we don't have to cut. But even David eventually is going to hit a brick wall if the state keeps cutting our money. I mean, there's only so much to do. We're getting a little bit of a reprieve this year with some unknowns for next year. Another thing we have to watch right now, there's a bill out there that could have a major impact on expenses, and we just don't know the impact yet. And that is the special education law that we expect, which would just potentially cost the district between $500 and $1 million. That's a real possibility. As of right now, we don't know that, but we have to consider that's still out there. There was another thing we used to be able to do called a healthcare waiver, where we were able to actually collect more money. That has been removed. So we do not have the access to that. It's about $1 million.
Correct.
That we used to be able to get. That's no longer available. We're at a bank cap, which means we wind up having to spend all of our money every year because we keep getting cut by the state, which means the tax in the town has to continue to be collected at its full speed. As of right now, we still cannot go above a 2%, so we are bound by that this year. We are going to a 2%. That is the max we can do, and we do need to keep doing that, or we would be in dire straits with our ability to program for our kids. The positive, huge positive, is this rateable. I'm going to do my very quick explanation of what that is. A rateable is, it's just the amount of money coming in from the town. But it doesn't mean the town gets more money. And that's a kind of a myth that people believe. Well, the town has more money. The town doesn't get more money. What happens is, if the town still needs $1 million, and it normally collects it from 1 million people, everybody gives how much?
A dollar.
But if we have now, the town still needs only $1 million, but we have another 10% people, now you have that $1 million gets spread over now that extra people. That's what happens. So there's not more money raised. It just keeps the taxes down. So more rateables, very positive. People like that because their taxes stay low. In fact, we're going to show you that in South Brunswick and our school tax, you'll see a cumulative decrease for the last 4 years in taxes, which is pretty good. People should be pretty happy about that. So anyway, that's pretty much what we face year in, year out. Dave, just go ahead through this real quick.
Just real fast on our 21 to 22 proposed budget. You can see we have a 2% increase in our tax levy. That's capped. We can't go above that. We've got tuition collected from some people or students who come to South Brunswick Township from other schools or from teachers who bring their students to or their children to South Brunswick. You can see the miscellaneous revenue. We pretty much pretty much cut that in half, only due to the fact that we just have not done anything with regards to facility rental. We haven't done anything with regards to bringing community ed money, any type of funds, revenue funds that we used to generate, just didn't happen this past year. Our state aid numbers is the $257,000 short. Extraordinary aid, we're budgeting the same amount that we had budgeted last year. Medicaid reimbursement is a little bit lower this year, but the state gives us that number based on previous years of Medicaid filings with our district. Our fund balance, a little bit less this year than last year, nothing really to speak of, about $40,000. And our general fund, you can see, is about $2 million more than the previous year, about $1.6 million more than the previous year.
$1.3 million.
We have some federal revenues. Every year with the federal revenues, we tend to collect a little bit less or budget less than the previous year, just because we're not so sure if all of those grants are going to be funded. So again, we budget less, but we expect to collect a little bit more than that, or close to what we collected the previous year. But it's an unknown, so we just want to be safe in budgeting and be kind of conservative. Our debt service, every year the debt service goes down just a hair. Our principal payment comes closer to the end, and the interest comes closer to the end. Just like any other type of, like a mortgage payment, you pay your interest off first. Our total revenue for the next school year, you can see, we're a little bit less than the prior year, and less our total expenses, again, a little bit less. So it's really, what we've put together was a flat budget. You know, we haven't done anything really major to increase the budget, yet we haven't really done anything major to decrease it. We're just keeping everything kind of flat and able to do that in this current budget season.
I just want to harp on what Dave said. You know, I know since at least the last 4 years, we've been able to manage the budget in a way that, if anything, people have seen more things occur for kids. Class size has not gone up. Staff has not been cut. Programs have not been erased. We've been able to manage that. And if you saw my presentation about a year and a half ago, my biggest fear is that we would not be able to maintain that. The good news is, right now, we are in good financial shape for this year going forward. And we just have a lot of unknowns we're going to talk about. But the good news is, even for next year, there's no changes coming that are going to be, oh no, this is missing, this is gone, class sizes through the roof. That's not on the docket. So this is what we keep talking about. If you look at the 21-22, third from the bottom, you'll see that we're at 21,488. We expected that number to be under 20. Why did we expect that? Because that's what the state told us, that you are going to be getting in the $19.5 million range. It didn't happen. Probably COVID-related, but it didn't happen. There's some other reasons we think might have been the reason it didn't happen. The problem is the state has not issued a new schedule to us at this time. So as of right now, if you want to look at the biggest cliff we're looking at, look at the difference between 21-22 and possible 22-23 if we go by the schedule the state has provided us. We're looking at what? About a $4 million drop next year. Not next school year, 21-22, but the 22-23 school year. Now, we don't still think that's going to happen. But what if we're wrong? We don't have the privilege of guessing and being wrong with $4 million of the taxpayer money and the money that's here to provide student education. So we have to continuously be looking at this possibility until someone tells us differently. Now, are we trying to get that information? Yes, there's a lobby group. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. But we just want you to know, we don't know if we're out of the woods yet. What we can tell you is for next year, we're out of the woods. I don't know after that.
The unknown. This is a very telling composition of pretty much our revenues and where they go as they come into the district. So we have a total operating budget this year of about $144 million. Of that, 80% of it goes, 80% of it comes from the local tax levy. About 15% goes comes from our state aid. 1% is other local sources, and the fund balance and our extraordinary aid are at 1% and 3%. So when you look at the composition of all the revenues coming into the district, the largest revenue that comes into the district is our local tax levy, and will continue to become the local tax levy. It will continue to grow only because of what Scott will talk about more, is the local fair share and the S2 funding, which is, you know, the state saying, hey, South Brunswick, you guys looking pretty good. You have to pay more of your local fair share.
Yeah, the state doesn't like that blue Pac-Man does not have a smaller mouth. They think his mouth is too wide. They want him to have a smaller mouth.
They want him at 90%.
Yeah, they don't want him at 80%. They think you should all be paying a lot more money for the schools. We at this table and the people in the audience disagree. So we're fighting. And we'll talk more about that. So this is just another version of the way it looks going into next year. You have our tax levy, you can see, is a 2% increase. You have the state aid, you're seeing is a drop of the 257. Extraordinary aid, we kept the same. Fund balance, Dave mentioned that, but what fund balance is, it's kind of a hole in the budget that you need to fill every year. It's an amount of money we take out of this year's budget to fill a hole next year. And anytime you don't fill that hole, that means the next year you just short that money. Or if you make that number too high, that means every year you have to find that much money to fill the hole. So it's just kind of we like to keep it static and drop it a little bit each year. So the goal is to drop that about, you know, as much as we can each year to bring it down. And that's kind of it. The rest of the numbers.
Just real quick,
yep,
on fund balance, just for everybody just to be aware, fund balance in South Brunswick has fluctuated from $8 million to $3 million or $2.9 million at a time. So that number fluctuates depending on the needs of the budget and depending on the needs of the district. It's like the funds that you have at the end of the year. You can put them into fund balance and carry them over to the next year, or reserves or whatnot. But that number does fluctuate.
Families with that money decide to go on a vacation, put in a savings, buy a new car. That's kind of what happens. We don't have those
salaries.
We don't get to do that. All right, let's keep moving on. Good news. This is what we're talking about. Next year, if you have a home that is currently assessed at $200,000, you will see a $90 decrease
in your annual taxes. Nothing wrong with that. And if you look at the $300,000 home assessed, not what it's worth, assessed, you're going to have to see $135,000, which means you're looking at about a $45 per $100,000 decrease as the number goes up. This is good news.
Just know this is your school tax.
School tax
only.
Not
your total tax bill.
Right.
Just your school tax.
So let's keep moving on. It's great news. We're very happy about that. We want to show you what this has meant now for the 4 years, including next year. In 2018-19, your taxes went up about $12. Still, very uneventful amount of money. Every year since, it's gone down. It went down almost $15 this year. I'm sorry, $15 last year, about $50 this year. Next year in that $100 range. Total, your school tax, since if you looked at your bill back in 2017-18, and what your school tax is going to be next year, it should be, if you have a $200,000 assessed home, your school tax is about $185 reduction over the course of that time. I can tell you that's rare to see a reduction over time in school taxes. Rare. In fact, you'd probably be hard-pressed to see it. Now, here's the really unique part of this. That's even though the state so far has taken $4 million of our money and said, you should be paying more. You're still seeing a reduction. I would love to take all the credit for that. Okay, I'm just going to take all the credit for it. No, I can't.
How did you do that?
It's amazing. I'm just that amazing. No, what happened here is the ratables in the town keep growing so high that even when our budget increases, the amount of money coming into the town allows that spread, which allows the taxes to keep going flatter. So it gives the ability for the district to manage the state's decision to cut funding without you feeling this major pinch each year in the taxes. So again, would love to be taking the credit, but really the credit we can take credit for is managing what we are able to manage in a way that we have not had to at any point take away from kids. That we're proud of. We don't take away from kids, and we don't take away from staff. And those two things, I think, are what continues on the mission and the excellence of South Brunswick.
This is a nice slide. I call it the big three. Dr. Parker and I talked about this a couple nights ago. It's really showing over the course of the past few years, your local tax levy and your general fund expenses continuously growing, continuously increasing, continuously moving up from, if you look at just your local tax levy in 2017, it was just over 100 million. Now you're pushing almost up to 116, 118 million. That's a growth. The growth in both of those general fund expenses and local tax levy, parts of your budget are just not in line with your state aid. If you look at the state aid across the bottom, it's either stagnant or decreasing. And it just goes to show that over time, it's just not a sustainable, budget. Something somewhere is gonna have to give. And unfortunate, and like what Scott's saying, we've never gone to student programs and we never will go to student programs, but there will come a time in your budget cycle where you're just gonna have to hit the wall and say, we gotta cut something and it's gonna have to be big. So that's a nice slide. I think it depicts a story, not a nice story. This also, Middlesex County Board of Taxation. This is a little bit about what Ray was talking about in his opening. South Brunswick continues to be at the lowest equalized tax rates in all of Middlesex County. Again, if you look at this, just in 2008 you were at 16, 2009 you were at 17, but if you look at 2012 all the way through to 2021, you've been either 22 or 25, or you're the top three, as in the bottom three, and that's just an amazing feat. Again, your equalized rate, it is comparable to other municipalities within the county. And again, it just goes to show that South Brunswick's values of their properties are
are
very well.
I can tell you, one of the shames of what the state is doing right now to districts like ours is you're getting punished for being fiscally responsible. Because you've been fiscally responsible for years, somehow that's bad, and now you shouldn't have money. And it's a bizarre concept that, you know, you'll hear more about it as not only tonight, but as well. One of our board members, Lisa Rogers, is leading a charge with our Support All Students group. So we'll hear a little bit more about that in a few minutes. So this is kind of what we do. Right now, the big deal is assessing the pandemic impact, specifically on academics and SEL. That is big for us. Dr. Disler is really leading the charge with Suzanne Luckborn and the admin team on what the academic side is going to look like. How do we determine the impact that has happened to students for the last, what will be 15 months of schooling? The SEL side, we have a team of people working on the SEL side and how we're going to know and assess and make determinations on what we need to do for these kids. And of course, operations, David and his team, what else is there that needs to happen as a result of the pandemic? Again, we have that $4 million, but that's the $4 million. That goes pretty fast with 8,300 kids. To give you an idea, we have 8,300 kids, we got $4 million. Newark has 35,000 kids, or four times the number of kids, and got 100 times the money. 100 times the amount of money. They got $400 to $500 million. So when you think about things that the pandemic has caused, every student has been impacted by the pandemic, not only students in lower socioeconomic areas. Every student, every one of our students, 8,300 were impacted. And we got basically chump change and compared to almost every district in the state, to be honest with you. And it's a shame, but I'm still not going to knock $4 million. We'll make amazing use of the $4 million. But I can tell you, if it was 25%, because we're 25% of the size of Newark, and let's say we even got 5% of what Newark got, even 5% of what Newark got, it would be a whole different game. It would be a game changer. Mm-hmm. But again, that's out of our hands. Nothing we can do. That was a decision the state and the federal government made. Again, unfortunately, no financial decisions other people are making are really helping South Brunswick. So we're kind of on our own with that. But I will say we're doing, thanks to Dave's work, thanks to our admin team's work, we are really doing a quality job of managing the funds so that people don't feel it. In fact, I honestly believe if I didn't say anything about funding in these meetings, I don't think anyone would know there's any kind of funding issue going on, because we really haven't impacted. Taxes are going down. Programs are the same or growing. I don't know what else we could possibly do for the community where taxes go down, programs either stay the same or get better. So proud of our team for that. That's amazing work. But we do this. We look at our efficiencies. We assess our enrollment, which right now is crazy, assessing our kindergarten enrollment specifically. I have no idea. I describe it as I'm blindfolded. I'm throwing darts at a dartboard that may or may not be there. That's the way I think of how I'm predicting enrollment in kindergarten. Just have no idea right now. We're looking at grants. Actually, there's a grant that's possibly coming, you know, available that hopefully we'll find out more about soon. And then we do a lot with the vendors. David does this. We make decisions on hiring or getting a service. We negotiated. Again, David negotiated with the busing contractors. We have a flat increase to our busing with our contractor next year. Flat. $3.2 million this year, $3.2 million next year. Good job, Dave. Yeah. And I think every 5 minutes, Dave, he either is telling me he's getting out of a meeting because he doesn't want to talk to me anymore, and he tells me he has a bid opening, or he actually really does have a bid opening because all we do is bid things all the time. I don't know which one it is.
I tell you I have a bid opening, and then I send Stephen Corso down to do the bid opening, and
that's
you're
what
out of my office.
Now I know what it is. Okay. All right. The truth comes out. All right. Next. Okay, so this is what I've been talking about. This is what we're going to end with tonight. Support Our Students is a group of about 100 districts. We've been involved at a high level at times. Right now, as I said, Lisa Rogers has led a group of board members in really getting the word out, organizing a kind of a blitz on Trenton Even though we're not currently as impacted as we thought, we can't stop. We can't rest because right now we are okay. That's a bad move. We need to stay in the fight. We need to do all that work continuously. So again, we have some really good people constantly doing this. I will say our township partnerships are excellent. We work very well with all of our township groups. People might know, I know this is public knowledge now, that our township administrator, Bernie, is leaving the town. Unfortunately, a big loss for us as well as the township. But I know they'll have good replacements. And David has a great relationship with the township, business offices, so always good. Legislators, specifically Assemblyman Zwicker, is always fighting for the district with that. Other legislators as well. We need to keep that up. We can't stop. Lobbying is very important right now. Again, just because this is an okay year, what if we get hit with a $4 million reduction next year from state aid? And believe me, there are districts right now facing that right now. And they've had those kind of reductions 2-3 years in a row of those massive reductions. Freehold Regional School District, Brick, Toms River, massive.
Oldbridge.
Massive. Oldbridge. Hallbridge got a $6 million cut again this year. $6 million. They're smaller than we are. They just got a $6 million cut. I think they got a $5 million cut last year. And one similar, it's unbelievable. So we can't rest because we're okay. That would not be the appropriate move on this district's part. We might be a little slower than we would have been, but we need to stay in the fight. And Lisa, do you agree? If you can't hear that, what Lisa just shared is that 4,000 people across the state sent letters, all S2 districts. Someone has to hear that whatever plan they thought they were doing good on, the negative impact of that plan is monstrous, devastating. Just consider $4 million next year if it's not here. This conversation is going to look very different if I'm presenting a budget with $4 million less money from the state next year. Trust me. It will not be this pleasant. Let's hope we're not in that mode, but the way to make sure we're not is keep lobbying, keep putting the pressure on, and keep joining our partners in the support of our students group. So again, to the board, I think we're at question time. And I want to thank you again for all your support in allowing us to do what we do and the support you give us and the direction and the guidance. Very appreciative. And again, no changes. This is pretty much identical to our last budget. But if anyone has any questions, now's the time.
Yeah. To the board. Board was sitting in the audience so they can watch the presentation. So they're going back to their seats. And I'll ask for any questions on the right. Dr. Parker.
Not so much a question, but I wasn't really happy with Mr. Fetter's description of ratables. There are really three things that affect your tax dollars. One is the amount of dollars needed. We call that the tax levy. So we're asking for $116,700,000. That's the tax dollars we need to run the schools. And then there's the township part, the county part, the fire district, so whatever the total dollars. Every property the township assigns a value to, called the assessed value, not the market value, the assessed value. That assessed value can change. If the district reevaluates, they go and change everybody's assessed value to make them more equal. But every time a property sells, the township adjusts their assessed value. The ratables is essentially the total of all the assessed values in the district. So you just sum up every property, assessed value. That's your total. And your share of the taxes is essentially your assessed value divided by that total. Some small fraction of this $116 million is your share of the taxes. And, you know, we can only adjust the dollars. We're allowed to adjust that by 2% a year. It's the environment that changes the ratables. You know, the township assigns these, but it's based on houses selling, property selling, businesses selling, all of these things, and that's out of our control. So because that went up, your share went down. Even though the amount we're asking has gone up, the total ratables went up far more than the amount we were asking for.
Okay.
So.
What else on the right? Guys up on top, you good? To the left. Okay, everybody's good.
All right.
Moving along. Thank you. I appreciate it, Mr. Federer and Mr. Pulaski. Mr. Pulaski and his staff have done a phenomenal job, and I want to personally thank the Finance Committee who did a fantastic job on top of that with David.
Mr. Nathanson, if I could just do a shout out for my business office.
Yeah, go ahead.
I have to tell you, the people in my business, in my department, they're outstanding. When we're putting a budget together, I can walk into any one of them and say, I need these numbers, and what's it look like? And they'll produce them in minutes. And to have a staff like that really makes my job that much easier. So I'd like to give them some kudos. They're a great group of people.
Yeah, it's important, and a lot, most have been there a very long time, so I want to thank them too. So moving along, we're going to the public portion. The Board of Education recognizes the value of public comment on educational issues, the importance of allowing members of the public to express themselves on school matters of community interest. Complete copies of the rules that govern the portion of the meeting are available to the public at the back of the room, or you can obtain an advanced copy by contacting the board office during regular business hours. We reserve the right to limit each speaker to no more than 3 minutes. It is our plan to listen to each member of the public. We will note all questions and comments made. Once all questions and comments made, comments from all members of the public are made, the Board of Education will respond, if necessary, to the question or the comments in the most timely and efficient manner available. Please consider not repeating comments and questions made by other members of the public. I ask that you state your name, spell your last, give us your place of residence or your party place affiliation. Now, we added last meeting since we've been back, we added this, and this went out to the public. All public comments will be accepted in person only. Board members will continue to be, board meetings will continue to be streamed live and can be assessed on the website prior to the start of the meeting at www.sbschools.org. We welcome and invite any who would like to make a public comment at any of our Board of Education meetings to please attend the in-person meeting. Meetings are held here at Crossroads North Middle School. Please remember, anyone attending an in-person meeting must wear a mask at all times and perform a pre-admittance self-examination exclusive of temperature check at the door. That is our new policy, and that's going to be read at every meeting. I'm going to open it to the public officially, but there is no one here. So I move to open it to the public. I have a motion. So moved by Mrs. Meadows, second by
no motion.
Mr. Keener. All in favor, aye. Good. No one here from the public. That being said, I am closing the public portion. Moving along, board committee reports. Anybody on the right have a board committee report? Mrs. Rogers.
Yes, just very quick. Just very quickly, the curriculum committee met Wednesday night. Myself, Joyce Smith, Jen, and Mr. Federer, and obviously Barry, Mr. Nathanson. I have to say, it was a really good meeting. We don't have the update yet because we have to do a couple other things, but I'm looking for, I think the board will be very pleased with the report next time. So we're really looking forward to presenting some of the items that the curriculum committee has done as well as working on. So thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else to the right? On the left, Mr. Scaletti.
Thank you, Mr. President. The facilities meeting, facilities group, we met on the 15th of this month. We started going over all the summer projects we're going to be doing throughout the district, paving and concrete projects around the district. Also talked about different sewer lines at the north and roof projects. We're also looking into the upgrading of the phone systems throughout the district. It's an ongoing conversation we'll be having. And we'll be meeting again coming up this week. That's all.
So that's it? Okay, we got to move quick. The pick is in on the Jets. So Mr. Federer is watching his phone. Yeah, go ahead, Mrs. Matt.
Okay, I just want to give an update for the policy committee. The policy committee met on the 27th of April. I am chair and had attended with Mr. David Pawlowski, Mr. Mike Mitchell, Mr. Raja Krishna, Mr. Barry Nathanson, and Mr. Scott Feder. And our policy committee met, discussed three policies that are on the agenda for first reading tonight. Please take some time to review them, as one of them addresses board member attendance and the process that the district will follow if we ever need to address this situation. Our second policy provides for homeschooled students the opportunity to participate in district athletic programs at the high school and at the middle school. And our last policy, 5120, addresses student placement in the district. So please, board members, take a look. If there's any questions, please reach out. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, I'm going to close the board committee reports. Next, approval of action items, consent agenda for tonight. I get a motion.
So moved.
So moved by Dr. Parker. I have a second. Second by Mr. Keener. Mr. Pawlowski, roll call, please.
Raja Krishna?
Yes.
Mr. Ray Keener?
Yes.
Mrs. Joyce Mehta?
Yes.
Mr. Mike Mitchell?
Yes.
Dr. Stephen Parker?
Yes.
Dr. Smitha Raj?
Yes.
Mrs. Lisa Rogers?
Yes.
Mr. Joseph Scaletti?
Yes.
Mr. Barry Nathanson?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Moving along, board committees on the right. Comments, sorry. Board comments? On the left. There are none on either. That's a precedent.
Just adjourn.
Unreal. Okay. Just good night, South Brunswick. We will see you in a couple of weeks. Yes. Can I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion.
Moved by Mr. Rogers. Mr. Rogers. Mrs. Rogers. Second by Mr. Krishna. All in favor? Any opposed? Thank you. Good night, all.